once again to be a master of ceremonies for this evening's programme. Philip Brady bowed out this year. The committee under the chairmanship of Angela Tudor put a great programme together, and a tremendous amount of work has gone into planning and organising this weekend, which has been very successful so far, I might have must add. I would like to thank Fergus Kennedy, who sent his apologies, the County Longford Arts Officer, and the members of the Ballymahon Municipal District of Longford County Council who support the festival, and Mary Reynolds, our County Librarian, and all those who give us support every year. I would also like to thank the members of St John's Select Vestry for the use of this lovely venue. It's my great pleasure to introduce a soprano, Corrinne McCormack-Bushell. I know Corrinne from, she's a member of the golf club in Longford, as I am myself. And last year I attended the opening ceremony of the 1916 celebrations in the cathedral in Longford. And Corrinne performed on that occasion. And I said to myself, I'd love to hear her sing in Edwardstown. So wishes can come true. And so you're in for a treat with Corrinne. She's accompanied here tonight by another man that's spent a lot of his youth, I think, here in Edwardstown playing tennis, Fintan Farley. So Corrinne and Fintan, thank you. Corrinne is going to sing Down by the Sally Gardens and My Lag in Love.
Down by the Sally Gardens.
two more pieces by Corrinne later on. We now come to the part of the programme that means so much, especially to the prize winners of the Mariah Edgewood Adult Poetry Competition. We had a great entry this year, and we were delighted when Professor Iggy McGovern, a physicist and poet from Trinity College, took on the task of selecting the winners. Iggy has published a number of collections of poetry and has a long association with the Strokestown Poetry Festival. Iggy has a special interest in Sir William Rowan Hamilton, who is a friend of Mariah Edgewood and William Edgewood, and who visited Edgewoodstown on a number of occasions and stayed in Edgewoodstown House. So it is indeed very appropriate that Iggy is here with us this evening.
So, thank you, Matt. Thank you indeed, and you and your committee for the invitation to this festival, which I must say is a splendid occasion. I'm sorry I could only be here for the one day, but I really regret that. You mentioned the business of judging. Judging is a terrible business, really. And I was thinking about this all day, in fact. Recently there was something called the Poetry Now Awards for the best book of poetry in the past year. And there were three judges. The first task they had was to draw up a short list of five. And so each of them drew up their own short list of five. And when they came to count up how many were on the so-called short list, there were 14 different books on the short list. And that's in the nature of art. Art is not like science. You cannot have a scientific judgment of art of any sort. It's maybe a little easier if there's only the one judge, but then the judge has to have fights internally with his or herself. Believe me, and I had significant fights over shortlist of three. I whittled it down to a shortlist of eight, and then I had to pick the three. And maybe on another day, it would be a different three. This is not to take from the eventual winners. I think there are three wonderful poems. And the ultimate accolade from this poor poet is, I wish I'd written all three of them. So what we're going to do is, in reverse order, going to announce and talk very briefly about each of the poems. And then ask the poet to come and read the poem. And then, do we award the prizes? Or not? Yes, I'll be there. Okay. So the third prize is awarded to a poem by Ivan Costigan, and what struck me immediately about this poem was, of course, the title. We had some discussion in the workshop today about titles, how important they are. And this poem is called Simplex Number 15,604. And the world, of course, is divided into those who do the simplex crossword and those who do the crossword in the Irish Times. And I do the simplex. So he was on a winner immediately with that. But this is a wonderful poem that it just covers that whole business of growing away from home and thinking about your parents, and notably in this case, Evan's father, through the medium of the crossword. The unfinished crossword. And if I say any more about the poem, I would destroy it for you. So I'd like to ask Ivan to come up and read his poem and collect his prize.
poem is about, I suppose, the relationship between a son and his father. It's also a poem about knowledge, specifically old and new forms. Simplex number 15,604. The countryside flashes past in a blaze of branches and Frisians roaming trackside fields. As I turn another page in the week-old newspaper, retrospective reading my latest phase. Opposite exactitudes of high tides and moon times, crossword of the day, 10 clues ticked off already. In rows and ladders of words, his capital letters. But my father doesn't do crosswords. He drives stakes to darker earth with blows from a sledge. Splits logs without care for sharpening an axe. Pulls sheep double their field weight from ditches. I stare again. It's hard to acknowledge. 10 across, piece of luggage, 8. Suitcase, the U sturdy as a two-pronged pitchfork. No surprise he didn't get Greek god of the west wind, 6. Or mythical sister with snakes for hair, 6. But how the hell did he miss 25 down? Loud cry of a bull, 6. I take up a pen, 19 down, expanse of scenery, 9. Landscape I enter, intersecting his N of never, S of strap, E of weeded. The white cells fill with letters, though I never finish. Outside the streaking green slows to a stop. Folding the pages in on themselves, I change trains at Limerick Junction and see I've missed my mother's call. Our carriage rolls back, jolts forward, on to 4 years of higher learning. Still, it stumps me. How he missed the loud cry of a bull, I'll never know. Thank you.
It's almost a prose poem, but it's such good language and it's so rich that it's a poem. It's a proper poem, yeah. And it's got set up in four sections: morning, afternoon, evening, and night. And the poem is about a life of a woman called Maud Dillap. And I was immediately sort of drawn in because her dates begin around 1877, so it just seemed to belong in this festival. As I say, very rich poem, and the whole poem is carried by an unlikely obsession. Here's a woman becoming a scientist in a period when they're not being acknowledged, their role is not being acknowledged, and it's the strange obsession is with jellyfish. And I have to say, I recall personally from jellyfish that this works so wonderfully well. So Dorney's not here, and has asked me to read this for you. Maud enthralled. One morning. In 1877, little Maud Dillap, 7th of 10, is running on the damp, dark strand of Valencia Island. Laughing backwards at a brother, braids flying in the wind until she skids. Sudden in the sand, a jelly bell, a lump of glue gunk spiked with ink, tentacles trailing from a fleshy pink. She is reaching for its plump ripples, but her siblings tug her back, screeching, "No, Maud, no, it stings." 2. afternoon. Grown, Maud rows a boat out on the ocean, alone. Alone when she peers through glass, it is into a deeper, dark telescope. She sees through waves to a world of hover and float, of swim and flit and gilled throats. Oars float, where Maud tilts over the boat's lip, peering past conger and pollock, ling and dogfish, until she glimpses her beloved bell and tentacle. A jigsaw, this riddle, adrift, a cloud tumbled down, a blown shroud, an umbrella, Cinderella's got all gone. It sucks up a handful of itself, then releases a lone float, alone. Afloat, Maud watches its lesson in the art of clasp and let go. 3. All afternoon, Maud is dredging, fixing nets, scribbling notes to herself on experiments. Then home again, fizzing air into aquaria, frothing drops through jars of jellyfish. Her shells heave with this exhibition of spin and dip, all her specimens hovering in saline fizz. Clotted blooms, globules streaked with crimsons and blues, they cannot hurt her as words do. Father said, no daughter of mine will leave home except as a married woman. Maud knows the etymology of captivate, how it holds both charm and a cage. 4. Night. Even after nightfall, they gnaw at Maud. They call and call until she rises, rubbing her eyes. Through the gloom, she moves in her frayed nightdress, her bare feet pale. She grips a candlestick, arthritic fingers sheltering the flame. Maud finds herself at her treasures in awe again. How strange that a life may come and go, until one night you find yourself alone with only a wall of jellyfish and box spools of notes. Her face is mirrored in the bell jars now, aged, changed. Maud is alone, afloat again. Are they there still, her jellyfish? Or have they perished too into copperplate curlicues? The liquid evaporates to silt. The jars tilt and the jellyfish leave Maud in the dark, lifting her fingers to imagine glass, the glass that always separated her from the dance. Maud, barefoot, enthralled. And first prize then goes to Paul Nash for his poem The Night Train Steward. And this is my favourite type of poem, the sonnet, and it's a brilliantly executed sonnet of the Shakespearean type. And it takes an idea of being on a train, seeing something about the night steward, it's the night train, and imagining stewards, past life, future life, somehow meshed in with his past and future lives, and using the ideas of the train and the tracks, the direction, and things like that to cement that idea. It's an extremely accomplished poem, and I'd like to invite Paul to read it.
Thank Professor Iggy for choosing my poem, and the organisers of the festival for a wonderful experience. It's been very stimulating. I enjoyed the talk this evening, seen by Susan as well, and John Bedders' talk at the very beginning. It's really been an encouragement to reread some of Edgeworth's books, which I encountered as a student. This is about, some of you mentioned the pictures, very nice gallery of pictures by Bernard Cannavan, I think it is, in the rectory, depicting the experience of the Irish migrants. And this is a poem from between the 50s migration, if you like, to England and the subsequent one of two or three recessions. And it depicts the arrival at Euston. I just should mention the theorem mentioned is the 27th proposition of Euclid, which imagines the parallel lines joining like the bow of a boat, just to prove that they couldn't possibly be parallel if they joined like the bows of a boat. Knight train steward. One more thing I should mention is that this man, who the steward in the poem, ran the night train refreshment service. So when you arrived in Euston, he would bring you coffee and biscuits, and that was rather nice. And then he went out to the station to start your life in London. The night train steward. With fading bruises of love and hate, hands out of one purgatory woke me in mine with a breakfast tray. Dawn's jolting demands clanking into place down the Euston line. So the first lone night on the wrong track ended. Commons of childhood, now another place. Our Eden lost, divided, undefended. Strange labelled fingers spelling out disgrace. The steel future snaked on to infinity. A mocking theorem of parallels, proving indelibly our roots were one. His sentence in the past and mine begun. To watch the heavens sweep by our chosen selves and get off the small case of dignity.
Joke about a cat. It's quite involved. I'm not going to attempt to tell you about it, but it basically explains what a judge is. A judge is basically somebody who is no longer able to do what he's judging. And I suspect that the invitation from Matt to read a couple of my own poems is just to demonstrate that. I'm very happy to do that. Very happy. No shame. So I'd like to, first of all, read a poem that has some resonances with the Edgeworth connection. Of course, Matt already mentioned William Rowan Hamilton, and this is an obsession of mine. The mathematician is something of a hero in many ways. And I've written a sequence of sonnets. There you are, sonnets. Based on the life of this man, and one of the people in the sequence is Maria Edgeworth, who is basically telling her part in Hamilton's story, as opposed to Hamilton's part in her story. Maria Edgeworth, author and friend. I think he came here first in 24, the long vacation, and my father dead some 7 years. It seemed to me he bore a close resemblance to that noble head. A second Newton, Dr. Brinkley says, a man of science and the arts to boot. His conversation cheered our winter days, while Reverend Butler quietly made suit to Harriet. I wished them happy lives. Indeed, there was no lack of choice to hand, for my dear father had it for all four wives, and father girls enough to beat the band. I thought young Isaac might engage another, but he had eyes elsewhere. Much to his bother. So you find out about the other one, you have to get the book. I'm going to just read two more poems. The first one is, we were having a little conversation earlier about people that are tweeting and all this type of communication. And I'm certainly finding myself on the wrong side of that debate. My son is a bit of a computer jock, and our conversations are somewhat fitful because I speak in Proverbs and he speaks in computer speak. So this poem is called Proverbs for the Computer Age. An apple a day keeps the hacker away. Bad news travels fast. Better to light one intel than to cursor the darkness. When the mat's away, the mouse will play. Necessity is the motherboard of invention. Every blog has its day. Fight virus with virus. All that twitters is not scrolled. Let sleeping laptops lie. And finally, beware of geeks bearing gifs. To finish off, you might have detected also in my some bias in my judging towards fathers, and fathers maybe sometimes not always there. My father worked in the license trade, and he just seemed never to be there. But at one stage we shared a bed, and that's, in some sense, it's kind of the closest that I've been to him in some ways. I keep sort of coming back to it. We also shared something else, and that is, I mean, there's no doubt about it that he was my father, because we have exactly the same shape. But, we are what is known as flesh challenged. Indeed, all of the McGoverns are, at least down our line, at least. I remember reading somewhere, I think it's Patrick McGinley, the writer of Donegal, writing that talked about the McGoverns as the bony arms of bog men from the Cappin. So this poem ends, it's called The Bony. When I shared a bed in 1952 or 3 with my bony father, I was led to believe that we were alone. Now I can own that when his bony frame closed in upon my back and he whispered something, my name, into my bony neck, behind him lay his bony father, and behind his bony grandfather, his bony great-grandfather, all that long-lined boniness lying in state. Their collective bony weight pulling him down, but slow, a little heavier each year, until he finally let go. And I fear he's here now, with the same bony crew, light as a feathery time. Well, they have a job to do, but not a word to my son.
Congratulations to the prize winners. I suppose we as a committee every year, when we sit down and we say, Iggy was talking about how difficult it is to be a judge, well, we have to sit down and see who are we going to invite, or who would we like to have in Edwardstown every year. And I think we definitely were inspired last year when we decided to have Susan and Corrine and Iggy here this year, and John Beddoes. So it's a very difficult choice for us as well, because we don't know actually who's out there, or it seems to be always new to us every year. So we're having a wonderful festival this year. We had a great day today, and we're having a great evening this evening. So I'd now like to call on Corrinne again, and Fintan, and Corrinne will sing I Dream a Dream and Danny Boy.
I dreamed that love.
festival, and we say, will we have another one next year? And then we decide to have one, and then we're full of apprehension all year putting it together, and then the week before we say, I wish it was all over. And then we come to an event like this and hear music like that and hear poetry like that, and we say, God, I can't wait to get organised next year. So we're coming near the end. I'm involved in a lot of things, and I go to an awful lot of meetings. I seem to spend my life at meetings, and I'm on a tourism committee in Longford, and you go in and all you hear is negativity and negativity about nothing can happen in Longford, and sometimes you get tired of it. And when you see what happens here in Edwardstown this weekend, and last weekend, I think the local drama group, put on a show over 3 nights, and the house was packed for 3 nights. And there's huge talent and there's huge vibrancy in Edgerstown. The Cultus group last night, you could listen to them for forever. We have our final performers tonight, the O'Reilly family. They've been playing here for a number of years now. They're great friends of the society, and it's no wonder that we invite them back every year, because they lift your heart. So the O'Reilly family.
Thank you.
made it on the international stage, and I'm sure the O'Reillys will make it on an international stage as well. You feel proud, I'm not a musician myself, but you feel proud to be able to stand here and say that these are young musicians from Edgefordstown. We're now coming to the end of today's events. It was a great day's events in Edgefordstown, and tomorrow we have something different in that we're taking a bus trip to Tullinally Castle. Richard Lovell Edgeworth invented and installed the central heating system in the first residential castle in Ireland. Residential. I heard yesterday, I think in John Beddoe's talk, that he invented a central heating system in a hospital in England. And we also heard that in one of her letters, where after they were coming home from a dinner party in Tullinally Castle back to Edgefordstown, the carriage drivers decided to have a race home and passing each other out on a snowy evening. And the two carriages ended up in the ditch. So I hope Tommy Gallagher doesn't do the same in the bus tomorrow. So that brings the evening's performance to a close. I believe if you want more entertainment, I see a poster down the town to say the Wolf Tones are in the Park House. So thank you very much to everybody. Thank you to the performers and to everybody who came. And we'll see you all again next year, please God.